In this video lecture, we want to give an introduction to some of the key methods you'll be using to manipulate string objects. Okay, let's get started. So now that we've seen how to create string objects, well, what can we do with them? FYI, note that from this point forward, I'll probably be referring to string objects and strings interchangeably. As always, the Java API is the ultimate reference on what can be done with strings. But as we'll see later, it's got a lengthy list of methods. So we need to focus on some of the key things we want to be able to do with strings. Some of the usual things we want to know about any string are: how long is it? How do we locate specific patterns within it? How can we extract specific characters or patterns from it? How do we transform it to upper or lower case? And how can we build longer strings from smaller strings? All of the examples we'll be going over in the coming slides can be found in the source code file stringusage.java, found in the usual place on Canvas. Once you've had a chance to view this lecture video first, please then take a moment to view that code walkthrough video. Open up the source code file in JGrasp so you can follow along. This is the interface for the string class length method. It takes no input values and simply returns the number of characters in the string as an int. For example, if we set up a string called greeting using its constructor like so, we can simply use greeting.length to return its length. Once again, notice that we are applying the length method to a specific string using dot notation, and that this entire right-hand side expression evaluates to one int value as shown in the interface. If length returns an int, any call to it plus the object it's attached to resolves to one single value. So this statement would be equivalent to writing int length equals 5. Here is the interface for the string class charAt method. If you provide this method an integer index value into a string, it will return the single character found at that position within the string. What do we mean by this? Let's say we have the string hello, as shown here, and then each individual character within that string has a zero-based index value. By zero-based, what we mean is that the first character of the string is at index 0, not index 1, just as for other zero-based languages such as C and C++. Then the last character of any string in general would be located at its length minus 1, as shown here. This is a general expression for the last character of any string that is always true. So for example, let's say we set up this string using this declaration and instantiation statement. Then we can extract the first character of the string with this expression and the last character of the string using this expression. Now this is okay and it gives us the correct result, but notice that it's hardwired for a string of length 5. The much preferred way, and the more general way that will work for any string, is to use an expression like this, which makes use of the length of the string offset by 1 for the last character. This part is equal to 5, less 1 is 4, which of course gives us the same result as above, but in a fully general way. This is the interface for the string class indexOf method. If you provide it with some string or some specific character that you're looking for, indexOf will locate the index of the first occurrence of that pattern within your string, or else a minus 1 if not found. So let's suppose that again we have the same starting string hello, as shown here, and an integer index variable declared. The indexOf method applied to the greeting string will find the first E character at index 1, the first L character at index 2, and the first LO string at index 3. But since the X character is not found within the string, a search for it yields an index of minus 1. Again, notice that we are invoking the method upon this specific string using dot notation, and that we are reusing and overwriting the same index variable with each of these method calls. The substring method of the string class is used to extract a portion of a given string and return a copy of it to the caller. What we need to provide to this method are the start and end points of the desired substring. However, notice that there's one little gotcha to this method which always seems to trip people up. The beginning of the substring is at this index, but the end of the substring is one character before this index, as noted here. And this is something it's common to forget about. So here's the same starting string as before. Let's say that we want to extract the substring from index 0 to index 2, as shown here. What we really get from this is the substring up to 1 before the second position, or HE, as we see here. The same thing applies to this example. Here, it's okay to use the length of the string as the second parameter, or a 5, even though there is no character at index 5 for this string, since we're really going to get the substring from index 3 to index 4. I've always figured that this kind of usage is maybe what drives this little nuance of substring. And since the return type of this method is a string, either of these right-hand side expressions evaluate to one string and are assigned to their respective string objects. To change the case of an existing string, we can use the toUpperCase and toLowerCase methods, as shown here. Both of these methods return a copy of the original string with a case changed as indicated, but note that in each case, the original string is left unchanged unless that return value is written over the original string. In other words, you won't change the case of your string by applying either of these methods alone. For example, let's say we set up the string greeting as shown here. Then if we simply apply the toUpperCase method to it, when we try to print that greeting here, we'll see that it still has its original value with only the initial capital. That's because the prior expression returned an uppercase value, but we didn't do anything with it, and it just fell on the floor, so to speak. In these next two examples, each of these method calls applied to the greeting string do return their respective upper and lowercase values, and we can see this if we try to print them out. But if we try to print the string again, we'll see once again that the original string is still unchanged. Only if we overwrite this uppercase value back over itself do we actually alter the string and turn it into uppercase. This is something that tends to trip people up when they're seeing it for the first time, so I encourage you to take a look at the code walkthrough video which demonstrates all this.